These artifacts came to the USC Archaeology Collection decades ago. They were actually donated by people who wanted to share with USC students for educational purposes real artifacts, real ancient objects, so that they could use them for study, they could get their hands on the past. The artifacts that we have here are all metal items, and we believe that they belong to people who were probably soldiers, members of the military in some fashion, or had some elite commission or high office, because they're heavy and metal was currency. It was actually worth money. And these, you know, axes like you see here and here, these would have been used by people who were part of an army, who were fighting men. These are the kinds of axes. You don't cut down a tree with this kind of axe. You put a hole in someone's skull with this kind of axe. And these were used in and around Egypt and in the areas to the north of Egypt, what we call the Levant, or what's now called Israel. The analysis that we're going to do at the Argonne National Laboratories uses a high-energy X-ray beam. And we can learn two important things about these artifacts. One, we can learn what they're made of. What kind of metal, what kind of copper alloy was used? Was it tin or arsenic or lead? How much tin? So what's the formula? What's the recipe? And is the recipe the same between, for instance, similar kinds of axes? So here we have a duckbill axe. You can see why it's called a duckbill. It looks like a duckbill. We want to know if these were made out of similar recipes, and we can get that information from this high-energy X-ray beam. The sword here, this one that's sitting in two pieces right here, and it's a really particularly shaped sword. As you can see here, it looks a little bit like a sickle that you would cut wheat down with. It's kind of got an arc and then a bend in the middle. And this kind of sickle sword is expensive and was kind of considered elite military technology in the late Bronze Age by the Egyptians. And there aren't too many of these around. This sword is in two pieces because it was highly valued. And it probably was, originally looked sort of like this. But in ancient times, it was heated and then bent and snapped in two pieces. We call it a killed sword. It was probably ritually destroyed so that perhaps it might have been placed in a tomb, and it still was a sword. It actually, you know, existed as a sword and was there, perhaps in a tomb with a warrior. We can't be sure of that, but it certainly wouldn't have been useful to any other warrior who dug it up. It's kind of a disincentive to using, you know, to trying to loot the tomb to get hold of somebody else's weapons if they're being buried with them. That's one possible way to interpret this. Well, this figurine is really interesting for a variety of reasons. First of all, it's made of solid copper alloy, so bronze of some type. It's also gilded with gold. And it's made with this white substance between the solid bronze and the gold leafing on the outside. And that's a tradition you usually see more used in furniture making. First of all, they're all metal artifacts. And they're from a tradition, a society where a lot of metal manufacturing was controlled at the level of the palace, on a pretty high level of society. So these artifacts can tell us something about how that society organized the production of these artifacts. One of the problems with knowing about ancient figurines is there are so few figurines preserved like this one, large, with a fair amount of their gilding intact. There are lots of traces of gilding on various figurines in museums, but there are very few that have this particular kind of manufacture. So this is a rare object that gives us a singular opportunity to find out something about the manufacture of these. We don't even really understand how these figurines are made, but we'll be able to get that information through the Argonne analysis.